I think we'll go ahead and get going. Thank you so much for coming to our year-end Bioscience Research Symposium. We have 10 seniors who have been working on their projects for anywhere from 1 year to 3 years to get where they are today. And we're gonna be, just so you know, we're gonna be going in three groups. The first group will have 4 students, and then we'll take a little break and have treats, and just like the honors program did, and then we'll have 3 more, and a short break, and 3 more. And then after that, our juniors, sophomores, and freshmen will have a poster session downstairs with more treats. So I think we'll just go ahead and get started, and thank you very much for coming.
Hi everyone, I'm Ileana. We're going to start off with a short video.
I used to get numbness in my fingers and toes. Particularly when I was in bed, I started to lose my balance slightly. I don't think I was picking the feet up, and I wasn't feeling where I was going with the feet. So walking, which has always been a great pleasure to me, and it's part of my fitness regime, became a problem. And playing golf, because when you're playing golf, you can actually measure when it starts and the effect. And suddenly I was wanting to sit down every 2 or 3 holes, and I couldn't really walk beyond halfway around the course before it was getting too much for me. That if I wanted to play 18 holes, I was having to ride a dreadful buggy and get mocked by everybody for, you know, being the wrong age group for riding a buggy.
So this video really highlights the impact the disease has on people's lives. The symptoms of this disease have been described as constant burning, numbness, and tingling in the affected areas. So what actually is happening with neuropathy at a cellular level is really the degeneration of the myelin sheath. So here we have a healthy nerve cell, and its myelin sheath here is intact, and that's really what helps the electrical impulses from the brain get to the muscles. And so on the right we have a damaged nerve cell with the excessive sugar in the blood of diabetics having eaten away at the myelin sheath. To put it in perspective, this is the population of the United States. An estimated 12% of people have diabetes. That's roughly 29 million patients and growing every day. Out of all the diabetics, approximately 64% of them have diabetic peripheral neuropathy. That's roughly 18 million people. So not only is this number staggering on a human level, but also the financial impact is pretty large. An estimated $176 billion are spent on direct medical costs, so that includes surgeries, doctor visits, and prescriptions. An estimated $69 billion are spent in reduced productivity, so that includes lost work days. And an estimated $137 billion are spent in federal funds, so that'd be Medicare and Medicaid coverage. More on the personal side, there's an estimated 73,000 amputations in 2010. Current treatments for this disease aren't very good. There's Lyrica and Cymbalta, which are originally prescribed for patients with depression and anxiety. There's also acupuncture, which has been proven to be effective to treat neuropathy, but the effects of the therapy are short-term, so the patient will have to go back very often, and that would get expensive. There's also amputation, but that's a very traumatic surgery and a big change in the patient's life. A similar device is an electrotherapy band by Neurometrics. And as you can see here, this man is having trouble. He has to roll up his pants, and it's not a very convenient device for everyone. Say a woman who would wear a skirt or tight pants couldn't wear this comfortably. Considering the scope of the problem, how large scale it is, and how little attention it gets, inspired me to develop a medical device to treat this neuropathic pain. The goal of my device is to be non-invasive, non-pharmaceutical, and convenient for everyone to use. I incorporated TENS unit technology. TENS stands for transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. How it works, the basic theory around it is that this device will send out electrical impulses to these electrodes, which then override the pain signal in the nerves. It hasn't been proven to be, this theory hasn't really been proven to work, but we know that TENS therapy is effective in treating pain, and there's no side effects. So here we have my first prototype. All I did was incorporate a TENS unit that we got at Walmart into the shoe insert. And although it did the job, I wanted to have more electrodes to deliver more localized treatment. And I also wanted to make this part of the machinery more of my own work rather than just use someone else's. So for my next prototype, I have the schematic here. It has four basic parts. We have the TENS unit, which sends out the electrical impulse. And that's connected to the circuit board here, which we code to distribute the electrical signal to the different electrodes. And then here the relay board is what actually divides up the signal and sends it. And then the actual shoe insert is what makes contact with the skin and treats the affected area. So here we have my second prototype. You can see the main difference here is the six electrodes rather than just two, and over here we have all this machinery. A couple problems with this was that it's really big and pretty bulky, and one of my goals was to make it be small and convenient to use. Also, diabetics have very sensitive skin, and they need to be wearing absorbent, clean socks all the time. And with this device, having to have the electrodes make direct contact with the skin, it's pretty hard to wear socks with that. So I designed a sock that has electrically conductive fibers that coincide with the spots on the shoe insert so that the patients can wear socks and have good treatment. So the next step I wanted to take was to make my shoe insert be like just one piece rather than having like wires coming off of it and things attaching onto the leg. So like what I would have liked to do is just have the battery and the circuit board and the power button all like on the thickest part of the shoe insert. But after consulting with a couple of engineering firms, I realized that was a pretty ambitious goal and I should have more of an intermediate step. So this is where I am now. This is my next prototype. You see here I've eliminated that long blue relay board and replaced it with these six transistors. And so everything is, I got this minimized circuit board as well. And so this all fits into a smaller package like that. So that's the end of my talk. If you have any questions or would like to see my device, you can come downstairs. I'll be available for any questions.
I have been in bioscience program for 3 years, and following I will show you my research that I've been working on for the past 2 years. So before talking about my clinical issue, I would like everyone here to think about a medical problem that you should have talked to your doctors, but you don't. I believe everyone has something in the mind. It might be a lump that you found somewhere on your body, or it might be a rash. For some kinds of reasons, people just don't talk about it. Following, I will show you a video about two patients sharing the same disease. Let's hear about their voice.
But it took me nearly 5 years to mention my symptoms to my doctor.
I've heard that as you get older, you may have to start going to the bathroom more often. But I thought something might be wrong when I started to have to get up 6, 7, 8 times per night just to go to the bathroom. I ignored it for a while, but then I found that my need to be near a bathroom started to interfere with my hobbies and professional life as well.
So the disease that those two are struggling with is called overactive bladder syndrome. And overactive bladder syndrome is also the topic of my research. Before learning about the bladder, we need to know some basics about the urinary system. The urinary system is really important in our body. It consists of two kidneys working together as removing the waste from the blood and producing urine. Then, the two ureters will transfer the urine from the kidneys to the bladder, and bladder is where you store your urine. And finally, the urethra will transfer the urine out of your body. So, how does bladder look? Bladder is not as simple as you might think. Instead, it is a really complicated structure. The picture on the right is a cross-section of bladder wall. In this picture, we can see that bladder is really a huge muscle which controls the involuntary work of your bladder contraction. So normally, how do people urinate? When someone's bladder is full of urine, as we can see in this picture, the bladder wall will be stretched spontaneously by the urine. Then, the stretching of the bladder wall will be sent to the sacral region of your spinal cord and then to the brain. And finally, the brain will react to your bladder wall to contract. This is how you can control your bladder contraction. However, how do overactive bladder people urinate? Let's see. So in this case, even when their bladder is not full of urine, obviously their bladder wall won't be stretched spontaneously. The signal is still sent to the brain, and then the brain will tell your bladder wall to contract, even though the bladder is not full. So after learning about the basics of urination reflex, let's learn the symptoms of overactive bladder syndrome. Feeling an urgency of going to bathroom, which means you have to go to the bathroom right now. And frequently going to the restroom, maybe over 10 times per day. And nighttime urination, waking up by urgency of urinate, maybe 2 to 3 times or more times. So the overactive bladder syndrome is not really a life-threatening disease. However, the thing that we really need to concern is that this disorder might affect all aspects of our life, because it might increase the inconvenience and the embarrassment. Also, the nighttime urination might reduce your sleeping quality and might relate to other chronic disease. So I want to find the prevalence of OAB in all kinds of age groups. Plenty of data has been done on by the researchers, and plenty of data could be found online. Here's a pretty typical one. I'm not surprised that with the age increases, the prevalence of OAB also increases. However, the really odd and strange thing that caught my eye was the age group 40 to 44. So this data really gave me the impression that OAB does not even exist in the woman who under age 40. So here's another typical graph. In this graph, we do have data of women who under age 25. However, under 25 years old means that the data lumped together all the result of college girls, high school girls, young girls, and even infants. So in such an inadequate and inaccuracy data, I want to find more and explore more. So here comes my project. It's overactive bladder syndrome, which is a disorder of middle age. Why might it be so important to determine the prevalence of OAB in high school girls? Because high school girls like us are so happy these days that we rarely go to see the doctors. So for the only chance that we go to see the doctors, it might be the problem of getting a cold or sore throat. So an ENT doctor simply won't ask you about the problem of the symptoms of OAB. That when they don't ask you, you won't talk to them. However, OAB is just one of those diseases that as soon as it be diagnosed or treated, the better the condition would be. So how do doctors determine if someone has OAB or not? They use a tool called OABV8, which contains mainly 8 questions asking about all kinds of symptoms. Let's see clearly. How bothered have you been by frequent urination during the daytime hours? And according to different comfortable levels, you choose different scores. So in this survey, when I add up all the numbers, if someone scored 8 or higher, she might have overactive bladder syndrome, and which also means that she should go to see the doctors for additional help. So I conduct this survey through SurveyMonkey to the SSM upper school girls. And throughout the whole process, it is completely anonymous and entirely optional. So let's see some of my results. Among 167 Shaddock upper school girls, there are 64 girls who completed my survey, which I really appreciate. And among 64 girls, there are 70% of them scores lower than 8, which means that they have low risk of having overactive bladder syndrome. However, the rest of them, which is 19 of them, scores 8 or higher, which means that they have increased risk of having overactive bladder syndrome. So here's the database that I found online. Let's see, where does my 30% result fit in this data? After the newly updated data table, it seemed that my result indicate that people, the girls whose age from 15 to 18, have almost the same prevalence of those who over age 75 years old. Why might my data be so high? What are those reasons? So according to my research, women who involved in high impact sports might have higher risk of having overactive bladder syndrome. So I decided to break down the result according to participation in different athletic groups. Among all the respondents that I got, 30% of them are soccer players. Hockey players have 17%, and 9% of them are figure skaters. So the rest of them are non-athletic participators, which is 42%. So here is the percentage of respondents with OAB over or equal to 8. As I have told you, I got the result 30% of them in all respondents who score 8 or higher. And after the calculation, I got 26% of the soccer players who score 8 or higher. And using the special statistical analysis, I got p-value equals to 0.78, which cannot really show the significance difference between all respondents and soccer players. And also, the hockey players have 36% of them score 8 or higher, and the p-value is 0.66, which cannot really show the significance difference. And finally, the non-athletic group, we have 27% of them score 8 or higher, and also I cannot prove the significance difference between the all respondents and non-athletic group. In this data table, I eliminate the analysis of figure skaters because we really got only a handful of them, so I cannot really make an assumption. And my conclusion is that my 30% may indicate that there is a significant prevalence of OAB symptoms in high school girls. However, the real reasons for the prevalence is unclear. And according to my p-value, I cannot indicate any association between sports participation and overactive bladder rate. And to confirm all of these results, I need a larger study groups which have more diversity in the population of high school girls. And if my prevalence proved to be right, or the real prevalence is higher than 30%, the physicians and school nurses really need to be encouraged to routinely screen this age group for OAB symptoms. Thank you for coming to my presentation.
And before I will tell you about my presentation, I want to tell you about my inspiration. So this is my grandma. She passed away 2 years ago when she was 68 years old, and she had diabetes for 30 years of her life. And I had a chance to see when she did her insulin injection, and she did some errors during the injection. Some of the mistakes was insulin overdose. when she injected too much insulin, and it's caused that she started feeling bad, pale, and she couldn't able to walk. Another problem was redness on the injection site, as you can see here. It was on her hips and abdomen. Also, the problem was the bruising. It wasn't that big bruising, but still, it sometimes appeared on her skin. So why did this happen? It happened just because she had Arrow's technique. That's why I decided to create a device to reduce insulin self-injection errors. And before I started to do my project, I decided to learn what is correct insulin injection technique. As you can see here is the cross section of your skin, epidermis. It's made of dead skin cells and it doesn't have blood vessels. Fat layer, it's made of fat cells and it has a few fat cells. And muscle layer is made of muscle cells and it has a lot of blood cells. And also it has plenty of nerves. When you're injecting insulin, it's supposed to be injected into your fat layer just because it has a few blood vessels. The insulin will absorb not that fast and it will stable level of insulin in the blood. And if you will inject into your muscle layer, the problem is going to be that it has many blood vessels. The insulin will absorb too fast and the patient will feel bad. Also, it can cause bruising, and because it has many nerves, it can cause pain. And if you will inject into your epidermis layer, the problem was that the insulin will not gonna absorb at all. So why does correct injection depth matter? As I mentioned before, you have to inject into your fat layer, not into your muscle and not into your epidermis layer. And also one of the important fact is you have to inject at 90 degrees angle because it's supposed to go into your into the right spot. And here you can see the example of incorrect injection error. So how often do people use correct injection angle? As you can see here on the table, 47.3% people who always inject the needle at 90 degrees angle. But also it's 42.6% people who never inject the needle at 90 degrees angle, which is a lot. So why is any of this important anyway? It's important because you can see on this graph that the number of people extremely increased, the number of people who got diabetes extremely increased from 1 million people to about 23 million people. And also it's 33% of fatal medication errors involve insulin dosage. And when I did the research, I found solutions for the correct depth because each person has different thickness of fat layer and thickness of epidermis. And here you can see one of the solution is the needle, different depth of the needle, length of the needles. And it doesn't, but it's, yeah, it helps with depth, but it doesn't help with dosage and it doesn't help with angle. Here's another really popular solution, insulin pen, which usually people are using. And it's good, but the problem is that sometimes after the injection, the insulin left in the cartridge. It means that the patient doesn't get the full dose of the insulin. And another solution for the dose, insulin pumps, which basically deliver insulin 24/7, the insulin into the body, but the problem that it's expensive and it's not really made for all people. And also I tried to find a solutions for 90 degrees angle, but I couldn't, so they didn't do anything. So basically, my design goals was to create, to help people to do a correct, with correct dosage, to do, to fix needle depth and injected at 90 degrees angle. Here you can see my initial drawings, which basically here is before the injection and here's during injection. And here's my first prototype. You can see the dial to set the dose. You can move it up and down, which basically will help you to check the dose of the drug. Here, the second dial helps to set a needle depth and 90 degrees angle. The flat surface area helps you to inject at 90 degrees angle. And here, as you can see, my second prototype, the dosage dial, needle dial, the needle, and the burial. Here, as you can see, how it looks when it's all together. And also, probably in this picture, you can't really see, but it has needle here, which basically shows that it's the needle protected. So yeah, thank you so much. If you have any questions, come to see me downstairs.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kevin, and first of all, I want to thank you for coming to our bioscience presentation today. I hope you guys will stay with me. All right, let's get started. So, picture this. It's 11 p.m., and you've been studying for an exam which you are not exactly ready for. Now, you got two options to choose from. You can either stay up and cramp in some more, or you can get to bed and have a good night's sleep. Now, which option would you choose? Let's hear what the science has to say about this. So when we talk about long-term memory in humans, we got two big groups. First, we got procedural memory, which is the memory responsible for learning new procedures, hence it's called procedural memory. And such procedures include how to tie your shoes, how to read a book, or how to fly an airplane, or even how to play a sport. And then you got the second group called declarative memory, which is the memory responsible for learning new facts, number, and events. For example, mathematical equations, your phone number, a special day in your life like your wedding day or your graduation day. So how is this memory processed in your brain? Well, it takes three steps. First, you got learning, which is when that information is introduced to you. Then in the consolidation stage, that information goes into your brain, is stabilized and stored in a little part of your brain called the hippocampus. And then during retrieval, you bring back that memory when you need it. The majority of the consolidation stage happens during sleep, and this is where my talk is going to focus around. So in a classic study in 1924 done by Drs. Jenkins and Dallenbach, they studied the impact of sleep on memory retention. What they did was they had one subject memorized a series of nonsense syllables, and then they recorded his memory retention over different time intervals, 1 hour, 2, 4, 8 hours. And in the first trial, they had the subject stay awake during these 8 hours. Let's see what his retention curve would look like. So as you can see here, his retention went from 100% down to about 50% just in the first hour. Now in the second trial, they had the subject sleep in between these time intervals, and let's see what his curve would look like. His retention still went down, however not as significantly as when he was kept awake. So seeing this positive impact of sleep on memory retention, scientists wanted to further study this. And in order to do so, they had to look for a population which had trouble with both sleep and memory. Because remember, I said this study was done on only one subject. And a psychological disorder called schizophrenia happened to fall perfectly into this model. Well, schizophrenia is often characterized by abnormal social behavior and the inability to perceive reality. And more importantly to researchers, patients with schizophrenia had a problem with their long-term memory. And they wanted to find out where sleep get into place. So in 2004, a lab in Massachusetts, led by Dr. Barry Manoek, conducted a study on sleep-dependent procedural memory in schizophrenia. And as I said, procedural memory is responsible for your motor learning. So they use a finger tapping activity to assess procedural memory in healthy controls and in patients with schizophrenia. Let's look at what they found. So in session one, or the learning session, as you can see, the triangles represent the patient with schizophrenia and the squares represent the healthy controls. And you can see the two groups perform equally well. However, after one night of sleep, the patient group performed much more poorly than the controls. And so now, knowing that patients with schizophrenia had trouble with their sleep-dependent procedural memory, our next question is if that apply to declarative memory as well. And past summer, I was fortunate enough to be able to spend time at Dr. Dara Manoek's lab, working alongside with the researchers there, and we produced an analysis on sleep-dependent declarative memory in schizophrenia. So, as I mentioned, if they use a finger tapping or a motor learning test to assess procedural memory, and what do you think they will use to assess declarative memory then? That's right, they use a word pair memorization task, or a verbal learning task. Let me explain this to you. So the subject would come into the clinic and he would sit in front of a computer screen with an instructor on his side, and he would be asked to memorize 20 unrelated word pairs. And by unrelated, I mean these words are not meaningfully associated in any way. So for example, see and marriage, or family and partners. And then during the test, the subject would be given the first word of the pair, and then he would be expected to give the second word as the correct answer. So marriage right here is the correct answer. Now here comes the interesting part. There are different types of errors that the participants committed, which would indicate different characteristics of their memory deficit. So for example, if the person said wedding, that would be called a semantic error, because wedding and marriage are semantically related to each other. And then the second type of error, so remember hardness was actually paired with family, and if the person said hardness, that would be identified as an intrusion error, because it was a different memory item that the subject had to learn, intruding the correct memory item. Let's have a quick overview of our methodology. So in the morning of day one, the subject came in and had the learning session. He learned 20 word pairs. And then he was given the first test. After that, he would stay overnight at the clinic, sleeping with an EEG cap on, so that researchers could measure his brain activity during sleep. And then in the second day, he would be given the test again. Here's what we found. Because we're interested in measuring the memory retention of both the healthy controls and the patient with schizophrenia, we want to establish a baseline for how many word pairs they could learn during their learning session. And in this case, we used 16 correct pairs out of 20. And as you can see, it took the controls about three rounds of practice to get to this baseline. However, it took the patient group about 5.3 rounds of practice to get to this baseline. And our p-value was 0.002, which was smaller than 0.05, so our finding was not due to chance. So this indicated that the patients with schizophrenia might have a problem with their learning process already. And then when we look at the overnight change in recall, or how many word pairs the subjects forgot after the night of sleep, we saw that the controls forgot slightly more than two word pairs overnight, when the patients forgot more than eight word pairs. And again, the p-value was more than 5%, so it was not due to chance. So this suggested that the group of patients had poor memory retention than the healthy controls. So as I mentioned, there were three different responses that the subjects could give during the testing. So the first one is just the correct answer, and then he or she could commit a semantic error or an intrusion error. If we look at the data for the intrusion errors, we found that the control group actually committed about the same number of intrusion errors in their first and second day. However, patients with schizophrenia committed a lot more errors, intrusion errors, on their second test. And also, if you look at the p-value for the first day, this is not smaller than 5%, so which is what we wanted. So in the learning session, two groups performed. There was no significant difference between the performance of the two groups. However, in the second day, since the p-value is smaller than 5%, we could say that the patients committed significantly more intrusion errors than the healthy controls. This led us to the conclusion that patients with schizophrenia had a deficit in their sleep-dependent declarative memory. And this finding, combined with the previous findings, highly suggests that there is some factor in our healthy sleep that heavily contributes to the consolidation of our long-term memory. For in the future, the Minogue lab is going to use their readings from their EEG and fMRI to actually understand the cause for this memory deficit in schizophrenia. So that's a picture of an EEG cat. Before I end, I wanted to answer the question that I raised earlier in my talk. So according to our current knowledge of neuroscience, going to bed is definitely the more beneficial option. However, I know that for one reason or another, some of us out there still choose not to do so. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much. We're going to take about a 5-minute break and change your speakers around, and we'll have another session with 3 speakers. Thank you. Okay, I think I'll get going again. We have three more speakers, and I want to thank you for tolerating. Apparently, my mouse arrow was in the middle of the screen the whole time, so you didn't notice it. So now we're full screen, so maybe that will be easier to look at. So we have three more speakers here, and I think we are going to go ahead and get started.
So, sorry about my voice. I'm feeling a little bit under the weather this morning. But my name is James Taylor. I'm a first-year bioscience student, and this is a project I've been working on for the past year. Okay. There we go. There's people who are still coming in here. All right, so this is a photo of an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, which means this man's heart has stopped and he is nowhere near a medical facility. Currently, EMTs are performing chest compressions and providing oxygen to the breathing mask right here. But this would be an ideal scenario if he had a cardiac arrest. Now, many of you know what CPR is, and many of you and many of you have the basics of CPR. However, also, many of you have a few misconceptions about CPR. Now, one thing that people don't necessarily realize is that CPR is not designed to restart the heart. It can do that with an AED, but you almost always need an AED for the electrical rhythm side. Now, also, the main goal of CPR is actually to provide a partial blood flow throughout your entire body when you're performing it. The heart is actually not necessarily the main goal. What is the main goal, however, is your brain. Because the brain is one of the most vulnerable organs to hypoxia in your body. Now, I would like to go over how CPR works a little bit. Now, this is a photo basically of an uncompressed or a normal heart. When you do compress it, you're pushing all that blood in the heart through the body due to the one-way valves that are in the heart, and you're pushing it against your spine with your sternum, and that's actually really important because you have two heart surfaces, and that is what allows you to compress the heart. Now, when you're doing it perfectly, when you're doing CPR as best as you can, you're only providing a quarter to a third of the normal blood flow throughout your body. Now, another issue in CPR is that rescue breaths only contain 16% of oxygen as opposed to the 22% in the air. Okay, this chart, a little bit confusing. This blue line is a percentage of survivors of CPR with respect to how long you receive CPR before you get an AED shock. Now, this red line is the percentage of the survivors that walk away with favorable neurological conditions, again with respect to how long you receive CPR until you get an AED shock. Now, to me, this was kind of a difficult graph to see because even in the best case scenario, like if you get an AED shock almost immediately, you only have roughly like a 36% chance to survive, and even if you do survive, a 22% chance to walk away well. So this led to my whole project, a selective cerebral perfusion device for out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. That's a mouthful, I know. This is a heart-lung machine. Now, what this device is made for is when you're performing a procedure on the heart, it substitutes for the functions of your heart and lung. The way it does this is it'll take blood out of your veins. At that point, the blood has no oxygen in it, and what it'll do is it'll remove the CO2, oxygenate it again, and then heat it up and send it back into the arteries around that organ. So while you're performing, that organ is perfectly fine. Now, for my device, I wanted to focus mostly on the brain, because again, most important organ in your body, right? Kind of what makes you human. So the way I was going to do this was by accessing the carotid arteries and jugular veins to kind of isolate the brain region, and that would just keep it alive. What you would do is you would take blood out of the veins and put it back in through the carotid arteries. And to determine if I could actually, or if I would be able to do this, I got a lot of advice from the professionals, namely Dr. Brent Merrill and Dr. Robert Speckles, who actually started the ICU at the local Fairwell Hospital. Now, I also, what they did was they confirmed that my project was actually feasible, and they also confirmed a few predicted difficulties that it would have, and then they helped work through those problems with me to kind of solve them. Another person I spoke with was a Dr. Keith Lurie. Now, he is actually pretty well renowned because he invented a CPR machine that is automatically the CPR for in place of a human. And that is a vast improvement. So one of the things that I observed while going up to his lab in the University of Minnesota was that if you have an inexperienced graduate student trying to catheterize a pig, it can take as much as 10 minutes, which obviously is a major problem if you're dying. So another issue that he taught me is another issue that he kind of informed me about was the most difficult thing about implementing the device is not necessarily creating, it's more the FDA, getting it FDA approved, and then marketing it out to the world. Now, after I spoke with them, tried to go on an ambulance ride along. I spent 7 hours at the ambulance wing, and they never received a single call. This is actually the early schematic of my device, so this was the original idea I had for it. These are basically organ lungs. The idea was from like a pig, or you know, just any slaughtered animal, so you could get them from like a farm. Not the best idea, for obvious reasons. First of all, these are easily perishable, so you have to get a constant supply. Second of all, you can't just store this device, kind of like an AED, because that is kind of what you want to do to make them usable. But I moved on from this to this new idea, where basically it's just a very small hard lung machine, a man portable hard lung machine. And this is just the early concept model I have. Right now, I have that downstairs, and it's also working, or it's flowing, or it will be flowing. So if you want to come see that or come ask me any questions, I'll be there.
Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to have a bit of a change of pace here. My name is Rochelle Vandermerva, and this is the project I've been working on for the last year. All right, I'd like you all to think about the different categories or groups within society that you belong to. So for example, I belong to the groups female, white, teenager, American, high school student, lives in St. Paul, rower, actress, etc. There are dozens of others. Now you might not think that all of these are immediately obvious as categories within society, but I bet if you think about each one of those, you can come up with stereotypes that are associated with all of them, meaning that at least subconsciously, we group people together based on these common characteristics or activities. And we can all agree that stereotypes can be dangerous, as they tend to be discriminatory and can lead us to make false assumptions about people. But stereotypes can be dangerous on an even deeper level. When people are in a situation where they're at risk for confirming a negative stereotype about themselves, and then that stereotype is in some way highlighted, they tend to perform much worse in that situation than had that stereotype not been highlighted. This is what's called stereotype threat. So what initially caught my interest about stereotype threat was a study that was done on a group of students taking the AP AB calculus exam. The point of the study was to determine if girls' performance on mathematics tests was affected by stereotype threat, because the stereotype exists that girls aren't as good at math and science, and standardized test scores in recent years have seemingly proved that to be the case. So how they designed this study was they split people up into two groups. The first group filled out their demographic information before taking the test, which then highlighted their gender and reminded people of their gender going into the test, whereas the other group took the test first, and then after that, they filled out their demographic information, so they weren't reminded of their gender going into the test. And what they found was that 4,700 more girls would have gotten a 5 on the AP test had they been able to fill out their demographic information after taking the test, so had stereotype threat in that case not been imposed. Now, as a female looking to go into the math and science fields, this was absolutely shocking to me. So I decided to do more research about stereotype threat, and I uncovered hundreds of different studies that prove that stereotype threat exists, primarily in to do with academic and athletic performance. As someone who's also very active in the arts and is a musical person and a theater person, I wanted to look at whether or not creative performance is also affected by stereotype threat. So originally, what I had thought to do was to administer a standardized creativity test to two groups of people and base the study off of what was done with the AP Calculus exam. So the first group of people would fill out their demographic information before the test, and the second group of people would fill it out after the test. So going into this, I was operating under the assumption that there were negative stereotypes that existed surrounding creativity, and specifically what I thought was that the stereotype that girls are more creative than boys existed. Now this seemed to be the case when I asked around, but when doing research about whether or not the stereotype actually exists, there is no concrete evidence to prove that people do think girls are more creative than boys. And in most cases, people actually thought that men were more creative than women, which makes sense if you think of the most famous musicians and artists and chefs. So at that point, because there wasn't a negative stereotype that existed relating to creativity and gender, in order to conduct a stereotype threat test, I first had to determine whether or not any negative stereotypes exist surrounding creativity as it relates to gender. So what I did was I created an implicit association test, which is a test that detects any automatic associations that people make when presented with visual representations of memories. So this is what the first part of the test looks like. I would show people the slide that had girls in this corner and boys in this corner, and then they would be shown pictures of boys and girls in a random order, and they would have to appropriately categorize those pictures. So in this case, the picture of the girl would go into this category on the left. The second part of the test was I had creative in this corner and non-creative in this corner, and then I would show synonyms of each, and people would have to appropriately categorize those. So in this case, imaginative is synonymous essentially with creative, so would be paired in this corner. Now at this point, once people were familiar with the different response variables, I started to mix and match them. So at first, I paired creative with girls and boys with not creative. And then at this point, I would show pictures of boys, pictures of girls, and then synonyms of creative and synonyms of not creative, and people would have to appropriately categorize them. So that meant that pictures of girls and synonyms of creative were going in the same category, and pictures of boys and synonyms of not creative were also going in the same category. So in this case, if you were to see a picture of a girl, you would put it over here, and then if you were to see the word inspired, you would pair it with creative, so they were going to the same side. Then I switched things around so that boys were on the same side as creative and girls were on the same side as not creative, and then you would have the same four options. So in this case, innovative, which is closely synonymous with creative, would be paired on the same side as a picture of a boy. Now what this test looks at is response time, because in this case, if you tend to think that girls are more creative than boys, there's going to be a subconscious lag in your memory, and it's going to take you more time to pair the picture of a boy with the word creative. So, I gave this test to a number of people, and what I looked at specifically was a calculated value called a D value. What the D value tests is the strength of the automatic association between the two visual representations that I showed people. So essentially how this works is the closer to zero the value was, that means that people don't, that respondent didn't tend to associate creativity more strongly with one gender. So here this value, -0.02, is really close to zero. So that respondent was essentially neutral and didn't associate creativity strongly with one gender. Whereas here, the more positive the value, the more strongly the respondent associated creativity with girls, so a respondent like this, and the more negative the value, the more strongly the respondent associated creativity with boys, so something like this. Now, I didn't have a very large sample size to work with, but I still played around with the numbers to see what I could come up with, and out of my 18 respondents, 7 of them produced negative D values, which means that seven of them tended to associate boys and creativity, whereas 11 tended to associate creativity with girls. This isn't exactly an accurate representation of the results because the D value specifically tests the strength of correlation. So what I did is I added up all of the D values that I got, and that produced a positive number. And then I averaged them out to get an average D value of 0.165, which means that on average, among our population here at Shattuck, people tend to moderately associate creativity with girls. Now, these results aren't conclusive on their own as my sample size is so small. So in order for the results to be conclusive, I'd have to I'd have to administer the same IAT test to a larger population. But if I were to find that there were no association between gender and creativity, then it's impossible for stereotype threat to be imposed because stereotype threat only exists in a situation where a negative stereotype is highlighted. But were I to find that there was a negative stereotype, that was associated with creativity as it relates to gender, then at that point I could conduct my my stereotype threat test as initially planned. I do have the implicit association test available if anyone wants to take it, and I will be downstairs to answer any questions afterwards. Thank you.
Hello everyone, so I'm Vivian Wei and this is my second year at the Bioscience program. So this year I'm continuing working on my project from last year, which is about heart. So this is a healthy heart beating, and as you all know that your heart rate changes. So your heart rate changes when you're asleep. It's lower down and because the demand of oxygen is lower than normal. And your heart rate rises when you're exercising because the demand of oxygen is higher than normal. And it's obvious that as you increase the exercise intensity, your heart rate will also increase. However, this is not the type of heart rate variability that I'm looking at. So let me explain. So this is a patient having an EKG taken. So all those wires on his chest are collecting the electric signal from his heart. And this is an EKG readout, which will be produced after the test. And there are a total of 4 spikes. At each spike, your heart contracts. So on this graph, your heart contracts 4 times. And there's a total of 3 intervals. And BPM is the unit we use to measure our heart rate. So it stands for beats per minute. And I'm going to use Fitbit as an example, because I assume that many of you have one. So on this picture, the Fitbit has BPM of 135. So how does it get that number? First, it had to collect 2.5 seconds of data, and then average the number, and then in this case, the number turns out to be 135 BPM. And this is a graph of the heart rate that was taken over like 2.5 seconds. So there's a total of 4 spikes, which your heart contracts 4 times, and you have 4 heartbeats. And there's a total of 3 intervals. So this graph is 76 BPM, but is it actually 76? So 76 in reality is actually an average. If we look closer to the numbers, at each interval there are different BPM. The first is 70 BPM, the second is 76, and then the last is 82 BPM. So at each interval, it does differ. However, it also does average out to 76 BPM. So how does this variation happen? So all of the variation, we sums up and called it heart rate variability, which we call HRV. And the definition is the variation in amount of time from one heartbeat to the next. So how does the variation occur? It is the autonomic nervous system that make the variation occur. So this is the nerves that control involuntary function of your body. So your brain collects outside information every second of the day. For example, your eyes, skin, ears, and nose. So every information will be sent to your brain, and then your brain will process the information and send it all to your heart and tell it whether to speed up or to slow down. So for example, when you see a lion running towards you, you will get nervous and all the information will be sent to your brain and the brain will send signal to your heart. And in this case, your heart rate will rise. Or when you are listening to some relaxing music, which you will feel relaxed, and then your heart rate will slow down. So when everything is working just fine, you will get a graph that looks like this. So as you can see, there are a lot of variation in from beat to beat. And this is what we call healthy HRV. So this is a graph that we want. We want a healthy HRV. So when your brain is not getting any signal from your body, or your brain is not sending signal to your heart, we will get this graph, which there are very little of variation exists. And this is decreased HRV, which is what we don't want. So why is HRV so important? So this decreased HRV is associated with 32 to 45% increased risk of first cardiovascular event, which is heart attack. So after finding out this, I realized HRV could be a new way that we can assess our heart health, which led me to my project, creating a wearable device that monitors heart rate variability to assess cardiac health. So currently there are a variety of ways that we can assess our heart health. So first of all, there are something that we don't have control over. For example, our age, gender, and family. And there are some that we have control over. Level of activity, diet, and stress. And there are some lab tests that we can do. Cholesterol, EKG, echocardiogram, and your weight. So what I'm doing in this project is that I'm adding HRV as a new way to assess your heart health. So the goal is to create a wearable device that uses HRV to predict the risk of first heart attack. And my goal is to create a device that looks just like a watch and it's convenient and easy to use. So how does it work? This is a prototype and I used about 2 years to get to the stage where I'm right now. So first of all, we have to turn on the switch and the switch will send power to the circuit board. And then the circuit board will transfer the power to pulse sensor and LED light. After the pulse sensor getting the power, it will collect every heartbeat and send those signals back to the circuit board. And then the circuit board will calculate the time interval between beats and standard deviation. After calculating those numbers, the circuit board will send signal to the LED light, and the LED light will light up in green, which you have low risk of having a first heart attack. In blue, which you have increased risk of having a first heart attack. And red, which you have high risk of having a heart attack. So after I plug in my device to my computer, this is the number I got. So those numbers right there are 10 time intervals between heartbeats. And those are measured in milliseconds. So when I graph out those numbers, the graph looks like this. And as you can see, there are very much variation occurs in this graph. And this is only just over 10 beats. So when this number goes into the circuit board and calculate out the standard deviation, the number will be sent to the signal will be sent to the LED light. And in this case, it will light up in green, which means I'm healthy. I have a healthy heart. So this is my current prototype. At the bottom of the case, there is a holder for your battery, charger, and the circuit board. And the pulse sensor comes out from the side, which goes around to the bottom of the wrist. And then at the top, the cover, there is a holder for LED light, which will alert the user. Thank you guys for coming to my presentation. If you have any questions or want to take a look at the device, please come downstairs after the presentation.
Okay, we're going to give you one more quick break while we set up for our final three talks, and there still are treats out there that you can have, and we'll be back in a few minutes.
Yeah.
There were tweets out there. I guess they were moved downstairs, so they are still there unless someone has eaten all of them, but that would be a bummer. So anyway, we have three more speakers left, and we will go ahead and get started.
My name is Tyson Auden. This is my first year in the bioscience program. Before we get started, I want to ask everyone a question. You guys can feel free to shout out the answer. So, what do these first two images have in common? Blue, or colors?
They're both weird.
They're both weird, yeah, okay. So yeah, colors, shapes, sizes, weirdness, they're actually all bacteria that's found inside of you. More specifically, found inside your gastrointestinal tract, and that's called your gut microbiome. The definition of a microbiome is the entire collection of microorganisms in a specific location. There are many different types of microbiomes. You have the microbiome of your right hand, the microbiome of your left hand, the microbiome of your nose, your ear, etc. There is even the microbiome of your whole auditorium. So thinking about the bacteria that exist inside your gut, scientists thought nothing of that. When they first heard that information, they were like, okay, we accept the fact that there's bacteria inside of us, big deal. It actually is a big deal. The current realizations are that it actually is correlated with things like allergies, diabetes, asthma, obesity, things that actually affect us daily. And so now that scientists know that, they think, okay, we actually need to study this. And so the first question they wanted to ask is, where do these microorganisms come from? Because if they can determine that, they can determine a lot of other important things. And so when you're first born, you actually have no microorganisms. And you look a lot like this. And so you actually, one of the first places you get microorganisms from is from coming into contact with your mother. And then as you get older, you get to go play in the great outdoors, and you get to go eat dirt, pick up worms, chew on leaves, whatever you want to do. And then, so you're obviously exposing yourself to a lot of microorganisms, and then you get older, and you start using common household things, like you use a door handle, you use the bathroom, all places where microorganisms like to collect. We all know that. And so by the time you get to our age, you actually look like this. So that's actually billions of microorganisms that are living inside and outside of your body. 80% of your DNA is bacterial DNA. You are a giant house for bacteria, basically. And so knowing all of this, there's a group of scientists that are part of the Earth Microbiome Project that want to categorize all the microorganisms in every microbiome on planet Earth, which is insane. One of the first places they wanted to look at was the New York City subway. So again, they're now looking at all the microorganisms of every microbiome in the New York City subway, another daunting task. So what they do is they swab every surface you can think of. They swab the kiosk, they swab the handrails, they swab staircases, they swab everything. And they found a couple of shocking results. The first one, not so shocking, they found E. coli, staphylococcus, bacteria that we're all somewhat familiar with, you've all seen before or heard of before. The next one's kind of weird. The 50% of the samples that they collected were actually unidentified microorganisms, meaning they knew that it was a microorganism of some sort, they just had literally no idea what it was. 50% of that, that's insane. The next is really concerning. They actually found the DNA of anthrax in the New York City subway. That does not mean that the anthrax is then living, it means that at some point in time it had existed in the New York City subway, the DNA is evidence of that. As if that wasn't enough, they also found the DNA of bubonic plague. Also a little concerning, but not so much considering it's no longer living there, but still rather interesting. So looking at this, I decided, okay, let's take this concept and let's apply it to Shannon. Why not, right? What could go wrong? So this is my project, the characterization of the microbiome of Shattuck St. Mary's. So there's a couple of important things. The first being knowledge. We all like to think that we understand bacteria pretty well. However, we really don't. We all think that maybe bacteria is not so good for us, but there's bacteria that is good for us. So the more we know about it, the better. And that'll actually help lead to more prevention. So obviously we have a lot of athletes in the school, so if we can prevent them from getting sick before nationals or before a bioscience presentation, that's a really big deal. We need to do everything we can to prevent that. And so another really cool part about shaddock is how historically old it is. Shaddock is hundreds of years old. And so we're actually at a higher rate of having older pathogens in our school, which is really cool. So the first step of my procedure was determine the areas to be sampled. So I wanted to look at areas that had high traffic frequency, meaning a lot of people come into contact with these areas on a daily basis. So those would be things like Shumway handrails, water fountains, tables, Whipple dorm rooms, very common areas. So here I am in my Whipple dorm room under my bed, and here I am on Shumway stairs. These are two out of some 30 odd locations that I took samples from. And so once I determined the areas that I wanted to sample, I then did collect the samples. And so you do that by swabbing it with what's called an e-swab kit, as you can see me doing here in front of Bayfield. After that, you then need to isolate the DNA. And why do you need to isolate the DNA? Because when you collect the swab sample, you actually have more than just DNA in the sample. We get human DNA, bacterial DNA, viral DNA, all of which is things we want. You also get shattered peanut butter, lip gloss, hair, toenail clippings, saliva, and a bunch of other really gross things. So the whole point of DNA isolation is to end up so it's just the DNA that you actually want to study. And so here's an image of Mr. Olson, our laboratory technician, and myself actually performing DNA isolation. And so once we do that, we then need to determine the sequence of DNA. So this is double-stranded DNA. Hopefully you've all seen this before, maybe. And so we all know that it's actually made out of thymine, adenine, guanine, cytosine. Thankfully, we can break that into T, A, G, and C. So if we were to read the specific part of DNA, it would go A, G, T, T, C, C, A, G, and so on. And so I was lucky enough to work with the University of Minnesota Genomics Lab to actually help me do the DNA sequencing. And this is what it looks like in the lab, actually. And so once we got that sequence, we then could use the sequence to identify the microorganism in the sample. And so the genomics lab gave this data through me to the PRIME database, and it stands for Quantitative Insights into Microbial Ecology, otherwise known as like the database that uses DNA sequences to determine the identity of individual microorganisms in various microbiomes. And so they gave me five tables. This first one is rather simple. It's actually the simplest one. It's at the species level. And then as I go on, it's going to get more in depth. So these numbers on the bottom represent the 26 different locations that I collected samples from. And all these colors represent different kinds of bacteria. So every color is actually a different type of microorganism. So it gets more complex. So you can see there's starting to get a few more colors, a little different, getting a lot more diverse, even more different. Finally, that is as diverse as our campus is. Versus the samples that I took. So that's very diverse, right? There are a lot of colors. I mean, the thing looks like a rainbow. So there's a lot of different microorganisms that exist. So I just want to talk about the first one for understanding's sake. So the first two areas, 1 and 2, are Fayfield tables, and they actually have a very similar population of microorganisms as, say, the handrails, the Whipple washing room, Whipple dorm room. You can see that they're all kind of very similar. There are a couple things that stand out, though. Like the Whipple dorm room floor, like in my bedroom. Why is that completely different than everything else? That's a little concerning to me, personally. So you can tell that maybe my Whipple dorm room actually has a very different microbiome than the Fayfield tables or the handrails around Shattuck, which is cool. A really concerning thing is this little red thing right there. So that is located in the laundry room and the washing machine in Whipple basement. And that little red piece right there indicates unidentified microorganisms. So again, we know there's microorganisms there, but we literally have no idea what it is, which is rather concerning. And again, if you look at this in the Whipple shower laundry and the common area in Whipple, the table on the second floor, that has an entirely different microbiome than everything else, which is really weird considering people sit there all the time. So what we can draw from these results is that we actually have a very diverse campus. We have a lot of microorganisms that exist on our campus, and it's very cool, and that hopefully people underneath can keep this project going. So I want to give a special thanks to Dr. Liberty, Mr. Olson, the University of Minnesota Genomics Lab, and the Bioscience Band. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Leo Lev, and thank you for coming and listening to my presentation. So, in your group of friends, there's always this person in the middle who trips and falls. And in my situation, it happens to be me, or my friend Daniel over there. We always fall, and as a result, this happens. A lot of sprained ankles. And a lot of people have sprained ankles, but not a lot of people know what actually happened in the sprained ankles. So let's look at the normal ankles first. So as you can see here, the ankles is composed of a lot of muscles packed together, and between these muscles are strong bands of ligaments, these white bands over here, that connected these muscles together. In most cases of sprained ankles, you will invert your ankles like this. And what happened is that these ligaments will be partially or even completely torn. So nowadays, there's a treatment called standard of care called RISE. So it stands for R for rest, I for ice, C compression, and E for elevation. And this is one rough interpretation of RISE. So as you can see, like, this person replaces eyes with a cloak, and that person compresses his or her ankle with a piece of scarf, which is fine, yeah, but there are still a lot of problems with this, such as the eyes, it's too messy, and it creates a lot of problems, such as you cannot monitor the temperature, and if you put eyes on your skin for a long period of time, you might get frostbite, and for some cases, people might get paralyzed for applying too much ice in a long interval. So for compression, in this image, it might look simple, it might look neat, but in reality, you might wrap it too loosely, which leads to nothing, or too tight, that might cause tissue damage. Yeah. So there are current solutions, like biomedical devices, that helps you alleviate these problems, such as the Game Ready for a few athletes here. This is a device that used really commonly in the sport complex. The good thing about it is it can monitor the pressure, the time, the eyes, but the bad thing is that you have to go to the clinics and you have to lie down the table, sit still. It's really inconvenient, and it costs about $3,000 to $5,000, which is not worth for like a sprained ankle. The next one is Thermotech. This one's slightly better. It's small. It also can still monitor the pressure, the time, the icing, but it's still weighs about 2 kilograms and it's still not what I'm looking for. So I feel like I can do better than this. That's why I'm trying to devise a therapeutic boot for treatment of sprained ankle. So the ultimate goal, of course, for this is to promote and support the healing of the sprained ankle. And second, it has to be lightweight, handy, and convenient, so you don't have to carry it around. And for compression, it has to monitor and stabilize the pressure, also as well as the time. For cold, I want to use a different source of cooling without ice because I want to avoid this messiness and the frostbite. I also want to monitor and stabilize the temperature and the time. And another important goal device is I want to incorporate a method called an alternating hot, cold, and hot treatment. So the RISE standard of care is really famous, but I want to I want to look for another one that has a better effect and result. So how this works is that this is your normal blood vessels, and by applying cold, you're able to constrict the blood vessels, and by applying heat, you're able to dilate the blood vessels. So by repeat this movement, you're able to create a what I call a pulsatile movement of fluids, which push the fluid and then the blood vessels, the white blood cells out of the injured area, which leaves a better place for oxygen to come in to heal the injury part. So how do I generate heat and cold? And we use a technology called thermoelectric tiles, which are these square tiles over here. So how does it work is that I will connect it to a current, like right here, and one side will absorb heat, which will provide cold, and the other will reject the heat, which create the hot side for me. So how does it work? So I'm gonna put the water flow into this water reservoir, turn on the thermoelectric tiles using a battery over here, and when the water's inside is cooled down or heated as I want, I will push the water away by a pump to a compression wrap. So this is a compression wrap before it's empty with that water, and it's after with filled with water. So how about monitoring of time, compression, and temperature? How can I do that? I would just use a technology called Arduino. So this allows me to program and set times and compression and temperature as I want it. Also incorporate with Relay, which helps me to regulate these components. And as a result, the product's gonna look like something like this monitor over here, where the customers can easily personalize and monitor the device that they want. So this is my first schematic sketch from 2 years ago. See, so you guys can see it's really simple. It's include a little bit, really little components. And as I got more advanced and more detail into it, and this is my first prototype, which I have the boot, the compression wrap, and a kind of simple circuit board over here. And this is my device now that I have for my prototype. So this is side view of it. So you can see the circuit board is a stick glued into the side of the boot, and all the commander is in this box. It's the pump, and this is to at least the water around the boot. And this is the back view of the boot. You can see this is the thermoelectric tiles, and then behind it is the reservoir that contains water. And again, this is the water loop that circulates water around the ankle. So this is how my device looks on the human legs looks like. So if you guys have any question and or even try on my device, welcome to talk to me after this presentation. And thank you for listening to my talk.
Lane Langenbrunner, and thank you for coming today. One thing we all have in common is that we are all faced with very stressful situations. And as much as we would like to think that our mind looks like this, it actually looks like this. And everyone has different ways of coping with this stress. For some people, maybe drinking a cup of coffee, maybe exercising, it could be listening to some music, or it could even be counting to 10. But in medicine, there's a specific name used to learn to deal with this stress, and it's called biofeedback. And so this is how it works. You have a person who is sending some kind of involuntary measurement, whether it be heart rate or blood pressure, to a device. The device is then giving audio and visual feedback, and the feedback is given to the person so they can alter their movement. So this is an example of a man using biofeedback, and he's having his blood pressure monitored, and so the information is being sent to the computer screen, and the computer screen is giving him a visual display so that he can either take deeper breaths or alter his movements in some way to improve his blood pressure. So in sports, biofeedback is really essential because athletes are always faced with very, very stressful situations. And one specific device that you can use is called the focus band. And the focus band focuses on brain waves. And so as great as this is, biofeedback has been shown in studies to not necessarily benefit everyone. And some people may think this has to be correlated with personality, which leads me to my topic. Are certain personality types more receptive to neurofeedback training, and specifically in golfers? And so the first step of my project was to administer a personality test. So I administered the Myers-Briggs Type Indicator, or the MBTI, and it looks at four different aspects. The first is where you get your energy from. Do you talk it out, or do you think it through? The second is how do you take in information? Do you look at the specifics, or do you look at the big picture? The third was how do you make your decisions? Do you look at the logical implications for the impact it has on the people around you? And finally, how do you organize your life? Is it through the joy of closure or the joy of processing? And through these four main questions, or four different aspects, you get 16 different types. And these are the results, and you don't need to get overwhelmed because I only had 3 participants for the study, and these were their personality types. The second part of our methodology was establishing a baseline putting distance. And this is called the PD50. So the P stands for putting, the D for distance, and the 50 is the percent of shots made, meaning for each golfer, we found the distance where they made 50% of their shots. And so this varied depending on the individual and their skill level as well. The next step in the methodology was doing the training sessions with the focus band on. So this is one of the golfers wearing the focus band, so we went to her PD50 distance and she did a series of 10 putts. And this is how the biofeedback works specifically in her. So again, you have a person, and specifically the golfer, who sent information to the device, and then gave audio and visual feedback into a phone app, which then relayed tones that she could hear to adjust her putting. And so this is what the phone app looked like on my phone. And we're going to start with the first one, is the mushin. And all the mushin is a Japanese word meaning no mind. So that's when they're in the right part of their brain or the subconscious. So to not get confused, we're just going to call it the general focus. And so this is a score that we wanted the golfers to improve in. And it ranged from 0 to 100, so the higher the score, the better. And then the green and red and yellow lines next to it are what was called the mental energies. So the green meant they were very focused, the yellow not very focused, and then the red not focused at all. And for the training sessions, the golfers could not putt until their mind was in the green state. That way they're training their brain to get used to this. The next part was the quiet eye, and all this was a more narrow and more specific kind of focus, and it wasn't really relevant for the study. And lastly, there's the baseline. So all the baseline is the amount of background noise that's going on in your head. So for some people, they may have a lot more worry, a lot more anxiety, a lot more pressure going on than others. We saw one golfer had 33 and another had 4. And this is what the avatar on the app looked like when it was lit up. So as I said before, you want the right part of their brain to be lit up, which means they're subconscious. So when they're taking a shot or they're putting, they don't have to think about what they're doing, they just naturally do it. And then you have their general focus, which is how you get the points and the score. And then you have their quiet eye, which is the narrow focus. And the last part of methodology was measuring the new putting distance, meaning you looked at the percentage of shots they made the first time at that distance, and then the shots they made the last time. And these were the results that we got from it. So golfers 1 personality type showed that they have stress that may cause outbursts, they dislike conflict, and they're sensitive to feelings, which in golf is very difficult to do, especially with all the pressure on you with each shot you have. And their PD50 with this biofeedback training improved by 37.5%, and their focus score improved by 41.37%. For golfer 2, their personality showed that they're focused, their attention may be obsessive, and then they're very intelligent. And they also showed that this biofeedback affected them greatly. Their PD50 also improved by 37.5%, and their focus score improved by 49.38%. Golfer 3 was very different from the first two in personality and in the results. They disliked theorizing about the future, they were organized, and they worked well with routine tasks, which for golfers is really impressive and incredible that you have to do. And their PD50 improved by 16.67%, but as you can see, it was only really a one-shot difference. And their focus score actually decreased with the biofeedback training. And this is a graph showing the 3 golfers and the personality types and how much they improved compared with one another. So as you can see, the first 2 compared with the 3rd. So what does this actually tell me? 1 is that the 2 types greatly benefited. And 1 is that the higher baseline score, the harder it was to focus. So it didn't matter which golfer it was, I noticed that you had to take their baseline every time you did the training session because it could vary from day to day. But whenever their baseline was higher, it was much harder for them to not only obtain their focus, but to retain as well. And so the implications of this were, 1, it helps recognize strategies per individual. So although it may look like it didn't help golfer number 3, it actually did benefit because when we were working with him, he noticed that when he closed his eyes for even 2 seconds, he was able to focus much, much better. Or even by taking a deep breath, or if he didn't do his pre-shot routine, then his focus score was absolutely awful. And so by doing his routine, he was able to obtain it much easier. It also helped me in realizing that it's useful for different points in your career. For a golfer just starting out, this could be an incredible method because you're starting off with learning good habits, and so you consistently work with them and train your brain to get used to them, as opposed to someone who's later on in their career. This may not be as helpful, just because you're so set in your ways, but it's good to be aware of what you can do to work with it. Thank you so much for coming. If you have any questions, you can talk to me down the stairs or the rest of us.
Well, thank you so much again for coming. Before we go, I just really would like to recognize 2 individuals. I guess it's dark in here, but I'd like them to stand up if they are here. Jim Picordi, who is our biomedical engineer, and Kevin Olson, who I know is over there, and he is a person who will help run. There, as I understand, there are treats downstairs, and our junior sophomores and freshmen will be with their posters, and the seniors will also be down in the art gallery area to show you their devices and answer any questions. Thanks again.